Seven Dials presents The Green Bullet, The Rise, Fall and Resurrection of Alejandro Valverde and Spanish Cycling's Corruption. Written and read by Matt Rendell. In memory of Steve Doherty and Rob Llewellyn. Epigraph. Books. Don't buy them without advice from a Catholic of real knowledge and discernment. It's so easy to buy something useless or harmful. José María Escrivá de Balaguer y Albás, The Way, Aphorism 339. You never knew our previous commander, nor are you acquainted with the society within which his thoughts took shape. You're limited to seeing the world through the eyes of a well-educated European, all caught up within the web of liberal democratic ideology. Franz Kafka, In the Penal Colony. Introduction. Rare bird. There's a theory that living in a world entirely made or modified by humans, with human purposes constantly reflected back at us, has changed the way our brains work, allowing the left hemisphere, which breaks reality down into abstractions and sees only what it sets out to take over. The many crises of our age, the climate emergency and mass extinction, but also urban gridlock, the obesity epidemic, the scramble for resources, and our own inability to discern other, better ways of living, may be the direct consequences. I sometimes think that cycling, and the immersion in nature and the landscape it makes possible, is a form of last gasp self-medication. Despite the bike itself being a mechanical, left-hemisphere sort of creation, and the tendency, even outside the professional sport, to talk about cycling in left-hemispheric terms, VAMs and VO2 maxes, watts per kilo, metabolomic pathway analyses, and so on. Perhaps to generations who feel they've lost control over their lives, to whom all these crises make tomorrow seem so uncertain, numbers, data, statistics seem to promise something you can depend on. At such times, Alejandro Valverde, Bala, not a lame journalistic invention but common usage, short for Bala Verde, the green bullet, from the breathtaking velocity of his sprint and the identical pronunciation of B's and V's in most varieties of Spanish, meets a need. His career stats would be impressive in any sport. Take that prestigious trio of races clustered every year around his birthday, the 25th of April, the Amstel Gold Race around Maastricht and the southeast corner of the Netherlands, the Flèche Wallonne from Charleroi to the top of the Chemin des Chapelles in the town of Wich in central Belgium, and the convoluted odyssey through the hills from Liège de Bastogne and back, a little further to the east. Titles every rider wants. Only Alejandro Valverde has triumphed in 5 Flèche Wallonnes, or stood on the podium after 9 editions. With 4 Liège-Bastogne-Liège wins, he lies second on the all-time list, one short of the cannibal himself, Eddy Merckx. Although in podium finishes, Valverde with 7 is Merckx's equal. At the Amstel Gold Race, Eddy outshines Ali, with 2 victories in a race Valverde never won, having had to settle for second place in 2013 and 2015, and 3rd in 2008. Even so, Bala's total of 19 podiums in all of the Ardennes classics makes him Merckx's superior, Eddy having accumulated, in his remarkable career, only 15 top threes in the prestigious triptych. Yet, to call Valverde, as we must, one of the very best classics riders in cycling history, barely begins to describe him. His skill set was so complete that on his day, as well as riding away from the purest climbers, Roberto Eras, Denis Menchov, Carlos Sastre, in the mountains, and limiting his losses to the great time trial specialists, and not all of the 8 time trials he won in his career were uphill, he could even, at the end of a hard race, beat the best sprinters, Eric Zabel, Stuart O'Grady, Oscar Freire, Tom Bonan, on the flat. This made any bonus seconds on offer at stage finishes as good as his, which in turn made him a master of one-week racing, as three Vueltas a Catalunya, two Criteriums du Dauphiné, and a Vuelta al País Vasco prove. In the stage races closest to his hometown of Murcia, the Vuelta a Murcia itself and the Vuelta a Andalucía, he holds the outright record with five overall wins in each, while at the nearby Vuelta a la Comunitat Valenciana, he's the joint record holder with three. In the great three-week tours, his record is equally remarkable. True, he won only one Grand Tour title at the Vuelta Ciclista a España in 2009, but by finishing third in the 2015 Tour de France and again at the 2016 Giro d'Italia, he became one of only 20 riders in cycling history to have made the podium in all three Grand Tours. Rummage more deeply among the statistics, and you find that of all the professional cyclists who have ever lived, only Bala has finished 20 Grand Tours in the top 10. 12 of these were his home tour, the Vuelta a España, a record for that race. 10 of his Vuelta top 10s were also top 5s, also a record, and 7 of these were podium finishes. That 2009 win, plus 3 second places and 3 thirds, another record. That said, he admitted, 3-week races are punishing. They mean a lot of days at your maximum, staying focused. I always end up having one bad day. I'm at my best in 1-week or 1-day races. Anything the numbers fail to convey, the comparison with Merckx makes clear. Alejandro Valverde was not just extravagantly gifted as a competitive cyclist, but an all-time great. In the estimation of the statistics website procyclingstats.com, the 7th greatest cyclist in history. Having said all that, Bala himself has always been averse to numbers. He says he only ever knew his win total because other people were always banging on about it on social media. In another context, where technology allows riders to know their power output in real time, he's always preferred riding on sensation. He is living proof that there are more forms of wisdom than the left brain hemisphere is ready to admit. However we try to fix it in data sets, the world never stops changing, and that applies to the past too. The moment we stop revising our conclusions is the moment we give up trying to make sense of the world. Any reader of Franz Kafka knows this. In one of his short stories, the inhabitants of an impossibly remote village in China suffer a strange confusion of present and past, mistaking the latest news from the outside world for ancient history, while filling their daily gossip with tales of long-ago abominations. In Kafka's telling, the journey from the capital to the furthest ends of the empire takes so long that proclamations issued centuries before by long-dead emperors are delivered as if published the previous day. A bewildering perspective, but a strangely familiar one. Kafka was writing before the age of live feeds and rolling news, yet he captures our experience rather vividly. By tea time every day, the morning headlines sometimes feel like the remote past. At the same time, the mass of granular detail buries the broad arc of history, making it almost impossible to make sense of the present. In a wider perspective, today's audacious interpretations make the past more fascinating than ever. You never know what's going to happen there. Early in Kafka's unfinished novel, The Trial, the protagonist, Joseph K., whose full name we never know, faces detention for reasons that are never made clear. He rushes back to his room to look for his identification papers, but all he can find is his bicycle license. Bala, too, spent his long career struggling to preserve his freedom to roam. And he too was a kind of genius, like a violinist who thinks with the fingers, the bow, and the feedback loop of sound created and sound perceived, or a potter whose thoughts are formulated by the hands, the wheel, the clay itself. The athlete's mind unifies brain, body, and equipment, baseball bat bike in what has been called the distributed mind. Balla was a brilliant exponent. He was an author of sorts, too, although the paradoxes, riddles, accusations, unfinished narratives, and mind-bending differences of interpretation that characterise Kafka's tales were not for him. Rather, Balla was a virtuoso in the neat, self-contained, zero-sum narratives that fill the sports pages, the hopeful start, the tactical choices, the decisive move, the concluding joy or sorrow of triumph or defeat. But both dealt in long time spans. By his retirement at the end of 2022, Valverde, born in 1980, resembled a swift-heeled emissary from another era. Mind, if Kafka had written about characters as warm, helpful, polite, empathic and uncomplicated, as well adjusted as Balla, he would have been a different writer. Attached to his family and roots, unchanged by success, a perpetual child for whom cycling, that most punishing of sports, always remained a form of play. Magnanimous in victory, generous in defeat, liked and admired in the peloton, an inveterate prankster, a leader and above all a winner, Valverde is almost as far from Kafka and his cast of overcomplicated masters of confusion and missed opportunities as it's possible to imagine. His destiny might even have been determined by his character. His extraordinary freedom from debilitating rumination had the proportions of a superpower. Instead of agonizing over his failure to win the Tour de France, Balla regarded his 2015 podium finish as one of his finest achievements. After defending his third place on the climb to Alpe d'Huez on the penultimate stage, before the Spanish radio reporters who used to swarm him like bees on every finish line, he wept, "I've been chasing this all my career. I've done it at last." With them, and with everyone who interviewed him down the years, Valverde was almost unfailingly patient, attentive, and amusing, even as he caught his breath. Self-deprecating, too, discussing his greatest one-day rival, Paolo Bettini, before the 2008 World Championships, he admitted, "If we finish together, I can beat him. The problem is, he's so switched on when he races, much more than me." Or consider this exchange from a recent documentary film in which Balla appears alongside multiple Grand Tour winners Pedro Delgado and Miguel Indurain. Delgado, now an accomplished broadcaster, asks him a characteristically thoughtful question. Delgado, "We were three-week specialists, and in our day it was said that you had to arrive with the desire to win. We absolutely had to. Whereas you always arrive having already taken your quota of classics and stage wins. I wonder if you start the three-week tour season with the feeling that you've already met your obligations, without the sensation we used to have, that it was all or nothing." Valverde, "Now you say that, it's possible. For instance, in this Vuelta a España, 2018, I won two stages in the first week. At the time, I wasn't planning to compete for the overall, but when you see yourself up there, you start fighting for it. But it's true that in the last week, when you have to give everything, the people who are really fighting for the GC, general classification, have something extra that I don't, and when the suffering starts, I find I can't do it and I come off the gas. And when you come off the gas, it's over." It's hard to think of another fabulously successful sportsman so frank about his shortcomings or so open to speculation about the content of his unconscious, and he still finished fifth. Or take that pre-2008 Worlds interview in which, after comparing himself to Bettini, he admitted, "When you're always chasing so many objectives, you get distracted over the course of 3 weeks and you lose focus. What I have to do is identify a single goal, focus only on that, and forget about everything else." The implication was that he would find it difficult. Another dimension of his psyche is suggested by the nude photo shoot he took part in for Interview magazine in 2003, the hair implant in 2015, more naked photography the following year for Quo magazine, and the pet parrot he named Figura, star, celebrity, and trained to repeat the words champion and handsome at him. But name anyone as successful in their field who's free from vanity, and Ballas is not of the arrogant variety. His sense of place is well known. He belongs in his hometown, Murcia, 400 kilometres southeast of Madrid, 200 kilometres southwest of Valencia, like a rare bird endemic to a single habitat. He complains about the tax rate, an outrage, 40-something percent, but he has never been tempted to look abroad for a tax haven. I've thought about going to Andorra to pay less tax, but in the end I don't want to leave here. I want to stay in Murcia. My parents still live in the village of Las Lumbreras, where I was born. I live 6 or 7 kilometres away. Becoming famous or better known abroad has never been an incentive for me. This is where I feel most comfortable, and that's how I perform best. It's the same reason I don't leave Murcia for Andorra. I need to be in my environment. Here is my family, the best climate, and my training group. There's wisdom in his recognition that he already has what he needs to be happy and at his athletic best. Yet Murcia is the subject of mockery in other parts of Spain, the Murcian yokel, whose speech other characters find incomprehensible, is a stock character in Spanish stand-up and comic sketches. A talk show host recently elicited applause from his studio audience when a guest suggested he had a hint of Murcian in his voice, and he retorted, quick as a flash, a Murcian accent, please, that's worse than an STD. Indeed, a nickname that attached itself to him when he was a junior, Torrente, torrent or flood, seems to derive from the relentless flow of his energy, until you discover it comes from Torrente el brazo tonto de la ley, Torrente the stupid arm of the law, a 1998 comic movie of questionable taste, in which the main character, Torrente, is a sort of overweight Spanish counterpart to the Naked Gun's Frank Drebin. A sequence in Movie Star Team's advertorial film series, The Least Expected Day, the editor might have labelled it Bala Breaks Wind in Car, suggests that Bala shares Torrente's toilet humour. The team's Latin American sponsors found the episode offensive, although the public explanation is simply that their speaking voices bear a certain similarity. More concrete matters distance Murcia from the rest of Spain. Many local families have interests in the production of grapes, citrus, and stone fruit. Yet the arid plain on which the city stands, the so-called Huerta de Murcia, literally the Murcian orchard or vegetable patch, depends for its irrigation on major engineering projects. While Murcians regard water as a right, outsiders struggle to understand the madness of trying to grow fruit in a desert. But Bala has never sounded defensive. If cordiality is a virtue in a public figure, as it surely is, he deserves public recognition. He received it in May 2018, when Murcia City Council made him an hijo predilecto, favourite son. He was, said the nomination, an ambassador for Murcia, which, as his homeland, has been present in every headline, interview or event in which he has been the protagonist. His training group, as Bala calls it, his Grupeta Murciana, is his court, a bunch of friends, some professional cyclists, José Luis Martínez, Eloy Teruel, others amateur, his brother Juan Francisco, José the Barber, his physiotherapist, Juan Carlos Escames, and others who gather outside Murcia's Iglesia del Carmen, just south of the river, opposite the Florida Blanca Garden, to ride with him. On a typical day, Alejandro rolls up with his Guardia Civil escort, and an hour or so already in his legs. From there they might ride to Señor Ángel's snack bar in Librilla, 25 kilometres southwest of Murcia, for 11s of jamón on toast, before intervals on the climbs of the Sierra Espuña, 20 kilometres further on, and then a food stop at Alhama de Murcia on the way home. Such straightforward routines gave him 4 years as the world's number one rider, one as world number two, two more as world number 3, and one each as numbers 4 and 5. His athletic longevity is revered too. Midway through his career, beaten by the veteran Chris Horner into second place in the final time trial and the overall classification of the 2010 Vuelta al País Vasco, Tour of the Basque Country, Valverde commented, "This year he's been very strong. I hope I'm riding like that when I'm 38. He was. In 2018, at the same age, he won the mountain stage of the UAE Tour, a stage, the points standings and the overall classification at the four-day Route d'Occitanie, and two stages in the points classification at the Vuelta a España, before going to Innsbruck for his 10th Road World Championships. It was likely to be his last chance, and the course, with a punishing ascent and a long, fast finishing straight, suited him perfectly. After nearly 17 years at the very highest level, he had already won 6 World Championships medals, 2 silver, 4 bronze, 2 more medals than any other rider in history, and had never finished outside the top 10. The question was, would his long history of near misses impair his judgment? 249 punishing kilometres ridden, 9 more to come, and the road tilts skywards. Romain Bardet, twice a podium finisher in the Tour de France, makes a jolting acceleration. The former track and field star Michael Woods, the World Tour's only 4-minute miler, continues the move. Only one other rider can follow, Bala, 38 years, 5 months and counting, but still with the hunting instincts of a wolf. Approaching a tight left-hand bend, 5 kilometres from the finish line, he drifts to the front, partly for safety, these corners require good positioning, and partly to ensure that the chaser, the Dutchman Tom Dumoulin, will have to expend valuable energy if he's to rejoin them. Dumoulin finally bridges across with 1.6 kilometres to go. Woods responds with a testing change of pace. Then, with 1,300 metres remaining, Bala takes over. There are 4 riders in the move now, and only 3 medals, and as the fastest finisher among them, it is Bala's race to lose, a thought he must banish. Approaching the Flamme Rouge, marking 1 kilometre to go, he positions himself beside the right-hand barrier so that the attacks can only come from one side, using all the expertise he acquired at the other end of his career, when, as an 18-year-old track sprinter, already the Spanish champion in the kilometre, he travelled to Havana, Cuba, for the 1998 World Junior Track Championships. Combining endurance events with sprinting even then, he finished 7th in the team pursuit and 8th in the kilometre, proving his versatility, although his real genius, it was clear, lay in road racing. Every second and a half he glances back. Dumoulin's attack comes just before his 4th look, but Bala sees it early and, rising out of the saddle, unleashes a burst of speed. The Dutchman has no choice but to desist. Tired after his solitary chase, Dumoulin knows now that he will not be the 2018 World Road Champion. Over the next 50 seconds, Bala, still hugging the barrier, looks over his shoulder no fewer than 15 times. It's the supreme demonstration of the race's art. In the post-race interview, he says, "It was a very long sprint. They left all the responsibility to me. When there were 300 metres to go, I said to myself, it's my distance, full gas to the finish line." Much later, he reflected, "In the heat of the moment, you're trying to keep as calm as possible. I knew I had started my sprint early, but when I see it on TV now, I think it's far too early. I'm more nervous watching it on TV than I was at the time. All the years of your sporting life pass in a second." It was the 123rd win of his career as a professional cyclist. Only one world champion has been older, Joep Zoetemelk, the Dutchman, 5 months Bala's senior. With his new world title, Bala was often paired up for TV interviews with a fellow Mercian, the Supersport 300 world champion Ana Carrasco, the first woman to win a solo motorbike world title. The social networks shook with laughter because Mercians talk funny, although the telling detail came on the evening of his victory, when the teammates who had supported him broke the strict diet of the elite endurance athlete by ordering celebratory hamburgers and chips. When they tried to tempt the new world champion into doing the same, he just said, "I don't like burgers," and carried on with his customary plate of rice. The discipline is as deeply ingrained in him as his self-knowledge and imperturbability. These are undoubtedly the personal attributes that permitted him to cope with the pressures associated with his position in Spanish sport, under which those rather confected records and deceptively simple sporting narratives readily deconstructed themselves into something less composed. After all, his impressive career statistics were achieved despite missing the 2009 Tour de France, having his results from the first 4 months of 2010 wiped out, and then being suspended for the rest of 2010 and the whole of 2011, during the part of his sporting life when he might have been at his strongest. His problems could be said to have begun on Wednesday the 24th of March 2004, when the Spanish sports daily AS, the word means ace, published the first instalment of a long interview with one of Bala's ex-teammates, the former Kelme Costa Blanca rider Jesus Manzano, who explained the team's internal doping system in greater detail than could possibly have been invented by someone with no professional pharmacological training, even if the Spanish Cycling Federation and higher sports council somehow professed to find him unconvincing and a perfunctory investigation dismissed his allegations. Even so, 2 years later, Manzano's confession led to a small surveillance operation surrounding a doctor well known in Spanish cycling. The mission, codenamed Operación Puerto, Operation Mountain Pass, eventually spawned several huge investigations, revealing what looked like a Spanish national blood doping program with inbuilt deniability. When the doctor, Eufemiano Fuentes, was finally arrested on the 23rd of May 2006, the only unambiguous name found among his personal effects was Valverde's, written in longhand beside four abbreviations, Ale, Manc, Vino and Popo, not that it took a genius, on the back of a silken hotel's business card tucked inside a black leather wallet. The Hotel Puerta de Madrid, which belongs to the chain, remains a popular overnight stopover with cyclists and cycling journalists. Among nearly 100 blood bags stored inside a freezer in the doping doctor's apartment, a bag containing plasma was found marked with the number 18. Two documents found in the same residence gave a list of code names. The number 18 corresponded to Valve brackets PT. A newspaper article about Bala appeared, mentioning a dog that he called Piti. The suspicion that enveloped him could have been dispelled in an instant with a DNA test, but Valverde's legal team spent years fighting to ensure it never took place, which spoke volumes. Even so, in the 20,000-word case summary submitted before the 2006 Tour de France to competitive cycling's world governing body, the Union Cycliste Internationale, UCI, the French Minister of Sport, Jean-François Lamour, and the race organisation, he went unmentioned. Nor did his name appear anywhere in the 360-page sentence issued after the Operación Puerto trial in April 2013, or the 84 pages of the appeal court judgment in June 2016, more than 10 years after the investigation began. Nor indeed in any of the 11,000 pages that made up the 36 volumes of the investigation and the 8 folders of annexes containing the documentary evidence, phone records, diaries, doping calendars, and other exhibits. He was as absent as the footballers, boxers, tennis players and track and field stars whom Fuentes also claimed to be treating. Operación Puerto dragged on and on from its 2006 inception. Judicial proceedings officially started 2 years and 2 months after Manzano's revelations on the 10th of May 2006. The trial instructions were issued 2 years and 8 months later, on the 30th of January 2009. That summer, the Tour de France director Christian Prudhomme complained that Operación Puerto continued to contaminate the sport 4 years after its beginning, but it had barely started. The DNA test eventually took place on the 2nd of February 2009. It proved that the plasma was Valverde's. After the sports system handed him a 19-month worldwide suspension from May 2010 to January 2012, resentment might have consumed him. Instead, he came back as good as before, if not better, and in any case, months before the 31st of July 2012, when the judge finally began hearing evidence in the criminal case built around Operación Puerto. The trial of Eufemiano Fuentes and associates finally took place from the 28th of January to the 2nd of April 2013. By then, one of the accused had succumbed to Alzheimer's disease, and another had taken his own life. Before sentencing at the end of April 2013, the legal teams representing the accused asked for the excessive duration of the investigation to be taken into consideration. The purely legal considerations left many questions unanswered. If bag 18 contained plasma, the clear liquid part of the blood, what had happened to the corresponding red cells, the part of the blood that delivers oxygen to the muscles and improves athletic performance? It was not hard to imagine. But it would also be illuminating to know what passed through Valverde's mind in 2006, when he learned first that Fuentes had kept one of his blood bags from 2 years before, and second, that it was now in the hands of the police. Why did he think Fuentes hadn't destroyed the blood bags and the documents that mentioned it? Did he imagine that the doctor thought of it as a form of insurance policy? If Bala is protected, I'm protected. If I go down, Bala comes with me. Or did he suspect that Fuentes kept it as material proof of his own importance, as the chemical assistant of the world's best cyclist? I never got the chance to ask. Cards on the table. I worked for Movie Star Team briefly, from late 2015 to early in 2016. It did not end well. In May 2015, in Sanremo, the first stage finish at the Giro d'Italia, Juan Pablo Molinero, one of the managers of Abarca Sports, the company which runs Movie Star Team, offered me a job. No one outside Spain wrote about Movie Star Team, he said. I spoke Spanish, I knew and got on with their stage race leader, Nairo Quintana, second in the 2013 and 2015 Tours de France, and victorious in the 2014 Giro. I was known and liked, half right, and I could give the team something it sorely needed, accessibility. It made sense. I had other reasons to accept the offer. Despite spending much of my time speculating about riders' motives, I had no personal experience of team culture. In this sense, I found the distancing required by journalistic ethics to be partly self-defeating. In addition, given the likelihood that Nairo, the world's most prominent sportsman of indigenous heritage, would win the tour soon, it was a unique opportunity. It was also true that, to someone who has preferred whim to financial responsibility as the star to guide him through life, the chance of a company pension had its attractions. So after months of emails back and forth, I called 20 years' worth of freelance clients to let them know I was no longer available and joined Movie Star Team as chef de presse. In November 2015, at the pre-season training camp in Pamplona, the newcomers, two Spanish neo-pros, an experienced Colombian, and me, were instructed to put on a kind of tunic and an item of headwear resembling a serviette knotted in each corner, stand on a stool, introduce themselves to the room, and make everyone laugh. When my turn came, after several adolescent anecdotes, I thought that an audience who spent a lot of its time on a team bus might appreciate a clever Bob Monkhouse gag that had gone around after his demise. It had the additional virtues of brilliance and brevity. When I die, I hope I go peacefully in my sleep, like my father, not screaming in terror like his passengers. Not screaming in terror like his passengers. Not a titter. A few minutes later, a number of riders and staff patted my shoulder gently and said, "So sorry about your father." I should have known then. At no point in our negotiations had Bala been mentioned. Even so, at that pre-season gathering, I found him to be one of those instinctively helpful people who open doors when your hands are full and pick things up when you've dropped them, always with a smile. A pleasure to be around. And prompt, too. In advance of the media day, I handed each rider an intricate timetable of his press obligations the following day, conceived to allow 36 journalists some quality time with 24 cyclists. Then everyone headed into Pamplona for the only dinner of the year where the entire team ate together. Food was followed by a night on the tiles. Riders were still returning to the hotel at 5 and 6 o'clock in the morning. My detailed schedule was history before it even started. Some riders disappeared completely the following day. Not Bala. He was in the gym at 7:30 a.m. and the hotel lobby in good time for his 9:15 a.m. press conference, dressed, breakfasted, beaming. He ran the show himself, as always. Before starting the job, I had not asked for, but had been given, and I quote, absolute autonomy in a number of areas. In practice, one press proposal that met with my approval ran contrary to Abarca's global strategy. Another, I learnt a few days later, clashed with company policy. Later still, I was informed of a special agreement that limited photographers' access to the riders and made a third project impossible. Furious, I demanded the exact wording of all three novel protocols in 24 hours. I probably left them with no alternative. I was convened for a meeting at a Madrid hotel. My team BlackBerry had been disconnected before my buttocks touched the chair. Before they left it, I had no job, no clients, and no income. After 5 months in the job, I left Movie Star for one of the older age group niches in the modern precariat. But the question still stood. Why was no one outside Spain writing about the team? Part of it was the same reason I came unstuck. Spain is different. It's not a land of ponderous philosophical systems like Germany or France, or the Industrial Revolution like Britain, but a place of mystics, poets, plaintive flamenco, and painters who stare into the abyss. If its geniuses are from long ago, Seneca, Averroes, Cervantes, Velázquez, the architects of Granada and Seville, more recently, it has given the world novelists, filmmakers, and architects, even if much of the outside world thinks only of blue skies so reliable they merit the tourist slogan, "Everything under the sun." It's a land of empty spaces traversed by deserted roads and of different species of silence, calm like the quiet of its hidden coves and beaches, contemplative like the meditations of its pilgrims, windswept like the landscapes of Don Quixote's windmills, tense, as in the moment before the striker of one of its great football teams takes a penalty, knowing, like the agreements between politicians and functionaries who abuse public power for private gain, duplicitous, like the furtive signs between the members of secretive organizations, deathly, like the unmarked mass graves of the Franco era. The holidaymaker on the beach, the student in the library or art gallery, the foreign employee in his first months working for a Spanish cycling team, cannot tell these silences apart if he notices them at all. According to one of the most dogged investigators into corruption in Spain, Operación Puerto fits a pattern. In his monumental book, El Fango, 40 años de corrupción en España, dirt, 40 years of corruption in Spain. The former magistrate Baltasar Garzón writes, "No one has ever been afraid to be corrupt in Spain. As something that has always been taken as read, corruption has not traditionally bothered the average citizen. This indifference has allowed its roots to grow deep and solid and to sustain a structure of interests that is very difficult to bring down. In Garçon's view, the justice system has contributed to this situation. Judgments that are laid down after long years of delay, accompanied by laughable sentences, incomprehensible dismissals or shelving of cases, unacceptable collusions and connivance. But corruption is not always about power and self-enrichment. For the vulnerable, it can be a necessary survival mechanism. And if, as the neuroscientists assure us, we perceive the world not as it is, but as it is useful to us, such accommodations are not necessarily conscious. Certainly, the Church offered the followers of the dictator Franco a religion that saw behind every sin its imminent forgiveness, and behind every sinner punctual redemption, as if the trespass was the necessary portal allowing grace to enter our lives, and was therefore to be welcomed. It is caricature, of course, as always, when part of a culture is taken for the whole. Pat McQuaid, the president of cycling's world governing body, the Union Cycliste Internationale, did this in January 2007, when, in connection with Operación Puerto, he spoke of a clash in the fight against doping between two cultures, the Anglo-Saxon and the Mafia Western European. The latter accept certain practices, he said, because of the way they deal with everything else in life. McQuaid concluded, "It is very important that at the end of the day the Anglo-Saxon approach wins out, because if it doesn't, then the sport is doomed." In a newspaper article that appeared during the 2012 Tour de France, in a slightly different context, Bradley Wiggins weighed in with, "I don't care what people say, the attitude to doping in the UK is different to in Italy or France." His column appeared the day David Miller, post-suspension, won the stage. It was the 45th anniversary of Tom Simpson's death on Mont Ventoux after mixing alcohol and amphetamines. And it's worth remembering the final report of a British parliamentary inquiry in March 2018, Combating Doping in Sport. In 2012, we believe that the powerful corticosteroid triamcinolone was being used to prepare Bradley Wiggins and possibly other riders supporting him for the Tour de France. The purpose of this was not to treat medical need, but to improve his power-to-weight ratio ahead of the race. We believe that drugs were being used by Team Sky, within the WADA rules, to enhance the performance of riders, and not just to treat medical need. Every nation believes it is alone in having a sure grasp on reality, and laughs at foreigners for thinking differently. And since the culture we inherit through the accident of birth supplies us with intuitions about what we can get away with, every country has its own preferred forms of corruption. To take one example, the Financial Times hoped in March 2022 that Putin's attack on Ukraine would bring to an end the warm home the British establishment and its financial system provide for dirty money from the post-Soviet sphere and elsewhere. So this audiobook makes no attempt to score nationalistic points. In any case, the most active and enterprising anti-doping authorities during the 20 years after 1990 were not Anglo-Saxon. Operación Puerto was discovered by diligent Spanish detectives and taken up by the Italian Carabinieri, who, armed with a full-blooded national anti-doping law since December 2000, listened into telephone calls, tapped email accounts, and pursued far-reaching anti-doping investigations. It was an Italian investigation that caught Alejandro Valverde, and, as we will see, Spanish-Italian cooperation that led to the downfall of Lance Armstrong. That said, of all sports, cycling has no choice but to ingratiate itself with the politicians, local, regional, and national. At the top of the cycling pyramid, the annual 3-week tours, though privately owned, perform a quasi-diplomatic role for their host nations of Italy, France and Spain. Heads of state and industry appear beside race directors, and great cities offer the international peloton the freedom of their streets. In the best of times, they showcase their nation's towns, villages, landscapes and transport infrastructure. In the worst of times, they have a state-recognized role in relaunching the national economy, as we saw in the aftermath of the COVID-19 lockdowns. Lower down, the sheer inconvenience of town centre starts and road closures obliges public bodies to weigh the unavoidable costs against the benefits of a day of euphoria as cycling's international roadshow comes to town. It has plenty going for it. Even without the influx of outsiders, their purse strings loosened by the holiday atmosphere, the competitors alone are numerous enough to provide local hotels and restaurants, whose proprietors invariably constitute an influential lobby, with an overnight bonanza. By granting nearby beauty spots a few seconds of airtime, television coverage promises local tourism a boost. The decision-makers get their moment on the post-race podium, handing out the prizes, reflecting the race winner's glory. If the photograph makes the next day's papers, all the better. In sporting matters, then, the dividing line between the state and the private sector can easily blur without much damage being done. But sport can get too close to politics. And this audiobook explores some examples of what can go wrong when it does, including circumstances where sports sponsorship was used to distract attention away from bad behaviour, years before the word sports washing had ever been coined. As for Bala, was he Chance the Gardener walking on water between the power brokers and the delinquents, oblivious to the rapacity, the dishonesty, the lack of principle? Or was he part of the conspiracy? And not just part, but at its very heart. 5 years after my movie star adventure, two cycling magazines, the British publication Pro Cycling and the wonderful Italian monthly Al Vento, asked me to interview Bala for retrospective features. I bumped into him on the way to a race, the Abu Dhabi Tour in February 2021, I think, and obliging as ever, he said he'd be happy to sit down with me. To set it up, I contacted his publicist, who passed my request on to the team, who never replied, much as expected. With no interview, I could never write those retrospectives and earn the income they would have generated. Movistar, mil gracias. Instead, my research turned into this book. I started and finished it, waiting for their response. Given frank, honest, uninhibited input from Bala, it would no doubt be very different. Alejandro is the expert on his own story. Only he knows the perspectives within which he sees it. But how much openness could I have expected? Revising the entire press record, I have found not a syllable in which he meaningfully addresses the subject of his doping, beyond a few baffling exercises in uncoupling words from meanings. We have to unite and say thus far and no further. I believe the time will come when this will all be over. Let's see if little by little we can change things. It was not for lack of asking. Ettore Torri, the anti-doping prosecutor of the Italian Olympic Committee, lamented in frustration that Valverde and his lawyers refused, in any of their many encounters, to discuss any substantive details of the case, addressing only procedural matters. So perhaps we overestimate the importance of the set-piece sit-down interview. The danger lurks therein of writing an official, approved biography. And what would be the point of that? So the quotations in this book come from media reports written at the time or soon afterwards, unless otherwise stated. As well as judgments and legal documents mentioned earlier, I've consulted the work of the following journalists, among others: Pablo de la Calle in El Mundo, José Carlos Carabias in ABC, Javier de Dalmases in Mundo Deportivo, José Andrés Esquerro and Juan Gutiérrez in the pages of AS, Fernando Llamas in Marca, and the reporters at the Murcian newspapers La Verdad and La Opinión de Murcia. I'm gratefully indebted to all of them, and especially to the brilliant Carlos Arribas of El País. The reluctant but acute and meticulous chronicler of Operación Puerto, and the author of a biography of Luis Ocaña that may be the best cycling book ever written. Carlos's texts underlie every page of this work. I, of course, consulted him before starting. Any intention on his part to write a book about either Alejandro Valverde or Operación Puerto would have made this one pointless in all ways, except perhaps one. El País, being part of the same economic bloc as Movistar's owner, the telecommunications colossus Telefónica, its reporters may have a little less freedom to adopt an independent stance. Of course, all errors in what follows are my own, whether of fact or of interpretation. An interpretation has to take into account the changing role of sport. No longer, almost a quarter of the way into the 21st century, a straightforward vehicle for Corinthian values, and far more complicated than war minus the shooting, it has everywhere become a testbed for ideas about values, selfishness and altruism, merit and chance, justice and freedom, that we explore in the suspended reality of sport, then put to use in our understanding of the world and ourselves, a central element in what is sometimes called the national conversation. And although we tend to be quite unaware of other countries' heroes and household names, many of them sporting creations, sport is also a means of intertwining national narratives and participating together in the international community. No wonder political entities everywhere strive to exploit these sentiments, and private sponsors pay to be associated with them. Chapter 1. The Wolf King. Monte Agudo rises 150 metres over the Vuelta de Murcia, on which Spain's seventh largest city sprawls. In ancient times, the pointed mountain offered farmers refuge from attack. In the 12th century, Ibn Mardanish, the Wolf King, built a castle there to keep watch over Islamic Murcia, and found the spot so agreeable that he added a palace and moved his court there. Ibn Mardanish had his detractors, one of whom traced his name back to its supposed origins in the Latin word merda. But in 1165, one of his civil servants had a son who, as Ibn Arabi, became a great Sufi mystic and author, celebrated the Muslim world over. When the great cultural flowering of Al-Andalus was finally snuffed out, the conquering Christian king, Alfonso the Wise, made a present of the castle and palace to his wife, Violante of Aragon, although Ibn Arabi remained Monteagudo's most famous son, until Alejandro Valverde. Born in the Monteagudo hamlet of Las Lumbreras on the 25th of April 1980. Today, a gigantic Christian statue uses the outcrop as a plinth, the Cristo de Monteagudo's placid gaze, outstretched arms, and commanding 14-metre height suggest a town united in its faith. Look more closely, and something like the opposite emerges. The serene face hides the strain of a long and bitter polemic. The current incumbent of that 8-metre pedestal is not an ancient construction. Completed in 1951, at the height of the Franco regime, he replaced an even more imposing statue, 30 metres halo to foot and 28 fingertip to fingertip, erected in the 1920s during Primo de Rivera's country, religion and monarchy dictatorship. The Catholic press described it as the work of all the people of Murcia, although this is hard to square with the city's loyalty to the leftist republic throughout the Civil War a few years later, and the city council's decision to have it blown to smithereens in November 1936. Victory in the Civil War by the Republic's enemies heralded a second coming, and it is the replacement monument that stands there these days, although now, as the old religions wane, camera drones buzz the Cristo de Monteagudo in the golden dawn, like wasps around a candy bar, catching the New Age vibe. As recently as 2010, a Mercian lawyer, acting on behalf of the Asociación Preeminencia...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.